business. He or she should do something else, because if we involve a member of the family that has not the passion, the interest, the capability to manage the business, he or she will for sure destroy the business. Guaranteed. Third trap, third problem that we have is that usually in family businesses, the family members remain in silos according to bloodline. Silos regarding the area of specialization. So usually if the founder is more specialized in marketing, also his or her sons will be a little bit bound to grow with the same education, even if they have not that attitude. So we should not bind anybody in the family to do the same things that we do. We should try to help them to develop their own skills and capabilities that can really bring value to the company by creating good training programs and mentoring programs that can help the family members to grow in the right way in their managerial skills and styles. So basically the key issue that we have in managing family businesses, in my opinion, is to find the right balance between family and business. And basically we have a key decision. Should we put the business first in our perspectives, in our vision, or the family first? All the decisions, the key decisions that we have to take about our business. So if we put business first in terms of family employment, obviously the employment policies should be based on the quality and qualification of our people, not on the base that they belong to the family. Once again, if you just include a member of the family in the managerial roles only because he or she is a member of the family, this is a problem. Second aspect, compensation. Obviously, if our approach is focused on making the business grow in the long term, the compensation policies should be merit-based. If you give more, if you create more value for the company, you will earn more. The problem is that in many family business, family-owned companies, they decide to have an equal compensation for all the family members. Whatever you do, you have the right to earn this. No company can survive for long if it adopts this approach. In terms of leadership, if you really want your business to survive, you should give the leadership to the most talented people that can really make your business grow. So you have to choose the right person, not necessarily a member of the family. If you're more focused on the family, the leadership will be based on seniority, but it's not necessarily linked to talent and capability to make your business grow. Resource allocation. If you are focused on the growth of your business, you will dedicate your resources to the growth of the business. Maybe you can dedicate a specific fund to the needs of the family, but the wide majority of the resources should be separated, put aside, and protected by the hungry family members and protected from them. Obviously, if you put the family first, usually you will use also the business resources for the family needs. But this, once again, is a road that leads to the defeat of your entrepreneurial venture. About decision making, if you have the idea of making your business grow, the decision making structure and leadership should be given to a managerial structure, once again based on merit and talent. Otherwise, you will concentrate the decision making activities on the senior family members. But once again, we need talent in companies, not necessarily relatives, sons and daughters. So, to conclude about the succession planning and about my speech, what we absolutely recommend is that we should start early in planning the succession in our family business in order to prevent problems and to find the right solutions that are not necessarily our kids. We should create career development systems that help our second and third generations to grow in terms of managerial competencies, in terms of vision on the business, and to specialize in the real areas of natural attitude. We shouldn't be afraid to seek for advice and to involve mentors, to involve external experts that can help us to better lead the company. Because it's very difficult to have a family where all the knowledge is already there. So it's very important to involve external partners. We should try to find solutions, for example, through the Family Act that helps to plan the succession with the general consensus of the family members in order to avoid those conflicts. And we should clarify the transition process in advance. You talk about the importance of communicating well this process, but once again, please do it in advance before the conflict arises and destroys the perspectives of the family. So, to conclude, as we have seen, family business are the vital resource of any economy in the world, Africa, Europe, Italy. It's vital to adopt the perspective that puts business at the first place, not the interests of the family. If we want the business to survive, we have a big challenge, a challenge to overcome the third generation. And we can do that by planning in advance the succession and carefully managing the entrance of new managers in the company. They are not necessarily the members of our family, but the most talented people. By doing that, we can make our business grow, our economy grow, Nigeria, Italy, Africa, America, anywhere in the world. Thank you very much for your attention.
I'd like to invite Mr. Idowu to please come forward to make a presentation. Please reach out together for Mr. Idowu. Mr. Idowu is the project manager in the agribusiness sector. The last couple of months, everywhere in Nigeria has been abuzz with farming, agriculture, and everything in that space, because the price of oil has gone down, Forex is a no-go area, so we're beginning to look inward, and everybody's remembering that we have acres of diamonds in Nigeria. And we're going back to where we were coming from. So Mr. Idowu is one of the people, the early starters in that sector, and he's milking already.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to be very brief, and I'm going to be sharing a very passionate experience that I had running a family business within my family. I'll just give you a brief background of the family business. The name of the business is Eriku Nigeria Enterprises Limited. It was actually founded by my father in 1981. And then he ran the business up until 1999. And then in 1999, I was then busy working with Egypt. I trained as an engineer from the University of Benin. And then, you know, the family thing basically in Nigeria. My father was growing old, and then he had three sons. The preference for the boy child family. And then, of course, two of my elder brothers were very busy doing their own thing. One of them was in the US, the other one was doing his business, and of course, I was the last son. And then they felt, him and my mom, between the two of them, they felt Idowu is our last chance, because they spoke to my two elder brothers and they were not interested in the family business. And then one day I came back from work and then my mom called me and she was like, Idowu, we need your help, we need to come in and then help to create the needed succession for the business. The father is getting old and all that. And then like the obedient child I did, I resigned from Aji. When I was resigning, my peers were like, Idowu, are you out of your mind? We all studied engineering so that we could work in the oil company. The salary is good, the welfare is good, everything is good. Is your father farm or Basojo farm? You know, what could be the benefit you would get from agribusiness? And then, but then I, against all odds, you know, I resigned. Just a year and a half into practicing what I went to the university to study. And then, of course, coming into the business, the first thing my father did, which was very nice, was to kind of, he didn't take me straight to the office to be the MD or to be the manager. No, he didn't do that. That was very nice. He took me to the various departments in the business. And then he told the people that were departmental heads that treat him like a staff, don't treat him like a business owner. And there, I was able to learn quite a lot. I first went to the pickering department. I had to get involved in the dirty job. And I was able to learn quite a lot from those that were managing those departments. And then I left there, I went to the poultry department, poultry section. I got some training there. Of course, I went to the feed milling department, got some training. Then it was also involved in oil palm, maize production. So I equally went to the crop production side. And then I learned quite a lot. And then finally, he brought me back to the office. And then he said, you're going to be a production supervisor. And then I started off from there, you know, then grew along the line. 6 years into the business, I eventually became the general manager of the business. And then he told most of the staff then that, okay, Idowu is matured now. I want him to take over this position. And then as at that point, of course, I've already known the nitty-gritty of the business. And then I took over, he was still the managing director, I was the general manager, and then, of course, the business was going on smoothly. And then I identified something. Two families were now involved in the business. I already had a wife there, she's sitting here with me. I had three children, three daughters. And then, of course, my father had six children. And then, you know, at the end of the year, we make money, and then the money has to be shared. You know, even my brothers, they were not involved in the business. They need to get, you know, part of the good. And then my wife was always telling me, you know, everybody's doing their own thing. You're sweating it out in the family business. You know, at the end of the day, what happens to us? And then, of course, one day, I walked up to my father. You know, the business, the one of the fundamental business which I've learned here today, which of course, if I'd known this some few years ago, things would have probably happened differently, is that most family business, there are no clear definition of even authority and ownership. You know, then I was just working because of the interest I had for the family business. My father didn't give me any shares, he didn't give me anything, I was only working for a salary. And then when my wife was talking about the future, the children, you know, I got worried as well. That peradventure, if something happens to my father today, of course all of my siblings are going to come up and everybody's going to say, no, we jointly own this together. And then I called him and I called my mom, which is one of the advice I'm going to give to Ope, who is one of you who I invited to this forum. Then I called my mom and I'm like, I'm working. Kenny is in the U.S., Ty is in the U.S., Muiwa is doing his own thing. What would happen if you guys passes on? And then my father was kind enough to say, okay, no, this is a good one. Okay, let us change the ownership structure. And then, of course, he did the needful. He gave me 20% of the business. He took 20% for himself. He gave my mom 10%. Then my five other siblings, as at that time, you know, I was like, okay, that brother, one, my younger sister just finished school. Then I brought her into the business as well. And then that brother was actually with me then. So we gave that brother 12.5%. And then three of my siblings, they got 10%. And then the last daughter, who's in London, she got 7.5%. And then I felt, okay, at this point, I think everything is fine. I got 20%. And then we went on with the business. And then it got to a point where I realized that if we don't grow the business at an exponential rate at which our needs were growing, because now three families were involved, we're going to quickly run into trouble. Because of course, everybody wants to travel, everybody wants to send their kids to go to school, and all of that. So I sat down with my dad again, which is usually the trend, that let's grow this business. And then we both agreed, okay, no, we can't grow with our internal resources. Let us go and borrow. So we all agreed, okay, we're going to borrow money from the bank. And then we're going to use our internal resources as a support. So we went for the first borrowing. We borrowed from Intercontinental Bank then. We borrowed 50 million. And then we did the first expansion phase of the project, which went very well. We were able to pay back the money in 2 years. We borrowed in 2006. By 2008, we had finished paying. But then it was stopped doing that. And then after the first expansion project, I saw the business growing. My salary was increased. The benefits were coming in. And I'm like, Dad, let's do this again. You know, this time around, let us go for 100. You know, if we could do the 50, I think we still can do 100. Let us double the growth this time around. And that was the turning point. That was where the issue came. My dad called me and then he said, you know, the marathon you took me through in the last 2 years, I'm in my 70s. I can't go through the same marathon. If we're going to grow, I want us to grow within our resources. No more borrowing. Let us look within. And at that point, you know, I was clear and I knew there was no way our internal resources could position us properly. Because of course competition is there, our needs and wants, our expenses were expanding. And then unfortunately the industry was getting much more competitive. And I'm like, Dad, we need to grow, just have to grow. You don't need this money, you're over 70. But I still want to maintain a good lifestyle. And then I tried to persuade him, I tried to talk to my mom, to talk to him, I called some of his friends. Because you know, when you're in a family business, the shares you even hold is transferred to you. You know, it's not like you brought in your money, your equity into the business. So you don't really have the final say. My father still believes that he owns 100%. You know, despite the fact that he has given out the shares to us then. He said, you know, I have the final say here. We are not borrowing. And at that point, I felt I needed to leave. Because the growth thing, I knew if we didn't do it, the business was going to run into trouble. So I had to leave in 2012. But fortunately, I left my younger sister. And then I started my own little business in 2012. While still trying to be considerate about the family business. I still go back once in a week, look at what they are doing, and all of that. But then the sad thing was, from 2008, even up till now, no expansion has actually taken place. Unfortunately, the business stopped operating last year, December. And we lost my mom in 2013. And then my father remarried. my father remarried. Of course, you know, the new wife always wants to get involved with what is going on. And then she popped into the business. There was conflict between she and my younger sister. Then, of course, my younger sister left the business last year, January. I tried to persuade her to stay, but she told me, no, you are not staying, so why are you asking me to stay? So she left in January. My father is now 78 years old. And of course, he doesn't have the muscle, he doesn't have the energy to run the business. So the business officially, he sold all the birds at the farm, sold everything out last year, December. And unfortunately, the business is no longer in operation. And then when I traveled this year to Italy, I met a friend, Inka. And then Inka happens to be Humphrey's friend, who is one of the organizers of this event. And when I met Humphrey, I told Humphrey my very bitter experience. And then we all felt there's a need for us to set up this kind of forum. Because imagine if the business was still around, and I was probably still there, the business would have been 35 years old this year, because it was started in 1981. And then it would have been in its second generation, with two siblings working very hard. And then what I needed to start off from the scratch now, which is my own personal business, would have possibly been an offshoot of the already existing business. And then each time when I travel, now we have some partners in Europe, my own personal business. We work with a company called Soundings in Germany. Soundings is about 54 years. And then when I asked about their ownership structure, they told me the father that started the business is dead. He had two sons. And they have two aspects of the business. One was into equipment manufacturing. The other one was running, they had a farm. You know, so each of the sons were managing each of the business. And then unfortunately, one of the sons died. The one managing the equipment business. The guy that was managing the farm had to take responsibility on both the farm and then the equipment business. And then when I was in Germany and I asked Gregor, how are you running this? He told me, he said, no, Fred still owns 50%. Fred, fortunately, is married. He has a son that is 19 years old, still in school. But then his mother is there in the business, holding his 50% shares in trust for him, depending when the son grows up. And then also there's a company in the Netherlands that we're also working with, Ottervanga. Ottervanga was established in 1909. You know, the business is in its fourth generation. And then when last I was in their office in Netherlands, I was asking Paul, how are you guys doing this? And he showed me his grandfather. The guy was, he's in his second generation. And then the guy comes to the office every day. He drives to the office every day. He sits in the corner, reads his newspapers and all of that. And then in the evening, he jumps into his BM, and then he drives home. The children have been able to take over the business. And these are the things we need to do as a nation. And that's why this forum is very key. It's very important. And most of the issues that, you know, created the conflict in my own family business, if only I had the opportunity of saying what I've seen today, especially Professor Antonio's presentation, maybe our family business will still be in existence. So I just want to share this experience with everyone of us in the hall. And thanks for listening. And I wish all of you a good day. Thank you.
Thank you, Anthony.
Very interesting story. You should convert it into a home video. So, no, but seriously, what do you think? Very instructive. But these institutions like Fit Foundation or the EDC, Leap Africa should share this with their participants. It just gave life to one of the things that Professor Ajogu Hadela has spoken about, the spousal factor. Your wife will call you and say, "Oh, Benny, nah, what are we doing here?" And thankfully, that wife that drew his hair is here with us. Okay, moving on now. Jide, is the video ready? Not yet, okay, so yeah, I'm sure that we'll have questions and answers. Idowu, so don't be too comfortably seated yet. I'm sure that as you were speaking, some ideas must have gone through people's heads and they would want to ask questions. Okay, so the first question is from me. I also run a family business. It's a printing company, and when I finished school, of course, my father also wanted me to join his business. This was 1999. My father didn't have a computer in the office. So every time he needed to produce something like this, he would go to a business center first and finish typing. So the only thing I was asking for at the time was for a computer. And he postponed and he postponed and he postponed and he postponed until he died. And then I had the capacity to take all the decisions by myself. But as I went ahead with the things that I wanted to do, of course, I met a lot of stumbling blocks. And before I go ahead, I mean, I think the role of the parents or the father figure is still very important, whether we like it or not. Because when that vacuum was created, I found it difficult to run as fast as I wanted to run. But then, back to the issue now, is when I started to do the things, I was making some improvements, and I noticed that people would always ask, is this business yours? Did your father hand over the business to you? And I'll say, no, don't worry, my sisters are not interested. No, they're all actually grown up. I mean, everybody's doing their own thing. And then I went to meet someone one day who had a bigger printing press. And he said, are you married? I said, no. That was 2005. He said, do you intend to carry on with this business after you are married? I said, yes. He said, I'll advise you to leave that business now. If you don't, your wife will tell you this thing. And I'm still running the business. None of my siblings has ever come to, well, you know, that thing continues to ring in my head. I'm doing an MBA at LBS now, Professor Ajogu, all of the things that he has presented today, he has told us again, time and time again, but I still continue to carry on because I want the business to go through a second generation and to a third generation. I attended Deep Africa's business leadership program, and they told us all those things about succession. And I called my sisters, I'm sure at least four times, that are you even interested in this business? They would always say no. But maybe I've not had the courage to say, just come and sign it off and say, young man, it belongs to you. So that's my first question. And I'm sure that beyond you, Professor Anthonio will be able to add a few nuggets to it. Okay, any other questions? Okay, so you do come and answer my plethora of questions. And did you run business schools? You can run business school, you can say a few things to that.
If you permit me to answer for me, please. Thank you. Well, that is part of the things we've mentioned here today. Ownership is a very serious issue. And then maybe not in your own generation, but maybe in the third generation. Somebody's going to come and ask questions, just like somebody's talking about their family inheritance here, looking at the fifth generation. So it's very important that everything is clearly stated in black and white. If they are not interested in the business, they should make it formal. And then, of course, you should do the needful by going to CAC and then taking real ownership with evidence, with legal instruments. You know, otherwise, I'm sure maybe you will not be asking that question, and then you might not even be able to answer it. But your children might be paying dearly if that is not done right now. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anything else?
Thank you. So I just want to confirm what the other gentleman was saying, and what I repeated, that if we really want to make our business survive, we need to involve just talent, not family members. And in Italy, we have a quite good example of this, which is represented by a company called Fiat. I don't know if you know, it's a car manufacturer. And basically, they founded the company, the founder, in one century ago. And apart from the founder, I mean, they were great in constantly identifying the best CEO outside of the company. So the family constantly managing the vision, the general strategy, but the CEO is always external. It's the best manager that they can find in the world. Now they have a gentleman called Marchionne, he's doing very well. They recently bought Chrysler in the United States, so they're growing, still growing, but the perspective is always involving the best possible executives and managers, regardless if they are members of the family or not, and planning in advance the successions or the future stages of the family by creating family acts or agreement that allows you to avoid problems. So when the conflict is already arising, it's very difficult to solve it. If we can prevent it, we have a solution.
My name is. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Tolu Adesanya. I have one question. My question is, what part does the Nigerian or African character, or ego in quotes, have to play with succession planning? I'm sure you know, anyone that's been following the news over the last year or two, there's been abdication of thrones about twice in Europe. I'm not sure the last time any throne or any point, any place in office has been abdicated in Nigeria, whether it's family or not. So what I find is that in Africa it's a peculiar situation. I'm not sure if we can relate directly with what is going on in Europe.